This has been a long year. A year of uncertainty, struggle, pain. We've watched a virus take countless lives. People we knew, people we loved. Jobs have been lost. Businesses have shut down. And churches have been forced to close their doors. We've witnessed division on an unprecedented level. Cities filled with violence. Streets filled with protesters. And we felt the sting of racism. The deep heartache of hate. There have been times where it's been difficult to see the hand of God. But even in the darkest of moments, He has been there, faithful, present, powerful. As a new year begins, we stand on a simple truth. Those who hope in the Lord will renew their strength. They'll soar on wings as eagles. They'll run and not grow weary. They'll walk and not grow faint. We don't know what this new year will hold, but we know that it's held by a God whose mercies are new every morning. This is where we place our trust. This is the truth on which we stand. This is our hope for the new year.
Grace and peace to you. My name is Pastor Doug, and I'm the pastor here at Portage United Methodist Church in Portage, Wisconsin. It is my privilege to welcome you to this worship video for Sunday, January 3rd, 2021, Epiphany Sunday. As we move into this new year, I want to take an opportunity to remind you of the many ways that you can connect with us online by visiting our website, by subscribing to this YouTube channel or liking our Facebook page, by commenting on these videos and our other posts. Engage us in conversation, share your thoughts, your reflections, your questions. We would love to be able to hear from you. And then share these posts on your own social media so that your friends and family can see them and we can continue to connect with others and widen our virtual opportunities for ministry together. Music centers us as we prepare our hearts and minds for worship.
Thank you. appear on your screen. Long have we journeyed through highs and lows. We follow God's signs in our hearts and in our lives. Like the Magi who searched, we come seeking the Christ child, offering all that we have in honor of the one born among us. Please join me in hymn 251, Go Tell It on the Mountain. God of wonders and signs, He created the whole universe, filling it with splendor and mystery beyond imagining. Just as You called the Magi and led them with a star, You called us today and led us toward where Your glory is breaking into our world. Too often, however, we overlook the signs You place in our midst. We are either unwilling or unable to distinguish them from the noise of everyday living. As we have become distracted by these things, we wander off and do not always follow where You lead us. Forgive us, O Lord. Clear our vision so we can see with fresh perspective. Open our hearts to Your presence, to the ways You are calling us. Here and now, give us what we need to go all in on this journey, trusting that You will be with us every step of the way. In the name of Jesus Christ, we pray. Amen.
Scripture reading today is Matthew 2, verses 1 through 12. After Jesus was born in Bethlehem in Judea, during the time of King Herod, Magi from the east came to Jerusalem and asked, "Where is the one who has been born king of the Jews? We saw his star when it rose and have come to worship him." When King Herod heard this, he was disturbed, and all Jerusalem with him. When he had called together all the people's chief priests and teachers of the law, he asked them where the Messiah was to be born. "In Bethlehem in Judea," they replied, "for this is what the prophet has written. But you, Bethlehem, in the land of Judah, are by no means least among the rulers of Judah. For out of you will come a ruler who will shepherd my people Israel." Then Herod called the Magi secretly and found out from them the exact time the star had appeared. He sent them to Bethlehem and said, "Go and search carefully for the child. As soon as you find him, report to me so that I too may go and worship him." After they had heard the king, they went on their way, and the star they had seen when it rose went ahead of them until it stopped over the place where the child was. When they saw the star, they were overjoyed. On coming to the house, they saw the child with his mother Mary, and they bowed down and worshiped him. Then they opened their treasures and presented him with gifts of gold, frankincense, and myrrh. And having been warned in a dream not to go back to Herod, they returned to their country by another route. Hear what God's Spirit is saying to the church. Thanks be to God.
When children play on Christmas Day and snow is flung, when I feel I haven't had a friend since I was young, when I'm feeling tired of myself and everyone, Lord, remind me, Lord, remind me. The shepherds heard the angels break the silence in the field. That the wise men found a baby and they could not help but kneel. That the one who heard our weeping became a child in manger sleeping. Lord, remind me. 'Cause it's Christmas and I want to remember. When I hear the news and hear another war's begun, and I wonder if God's on the side of either one, I hear bullet, nail, or handcuff, you bore all of them, and in the light my heart's as dark as any. Shepherds heard the angels break the silence in the field. That the wise men found a baby and they could not help but kneel. That the one who heard our weeping became a child in manger sleeping. Lord, remind me. 'Cause it's Christmas and I want to remember. Tell me how he loves me, tell me how he wants me, tell me the story like I've never heard before. And I'll sing it like the angels sing it, with my whole heart singing to him who's worth a thousand songs and more. Shines when nothing seems to shine. paralytic rose and stood up proud on his own feet. Let the thief who hung beside you is with you now and waits for me. Let the cry of faith so simple, it's the greatest song in heaven's hymn. Oh, Lord, remind me. 'Cause it's Christmas and I want to remember.
Let us pray. May the words of my mouth and the meditations of all our hearts be acceptable in thy sight, O Lord, our strength and our Redeemer. Amen. In the last several days, I've seen various individuals, organizations, and news outlets sharing their thoughts about ringing in the new year. Many have focused on the struggles and the challenges of the past 12 months, while some have at least tried to find a silver lining. Yet most of them would agree that 2020 has affected everyone in one way or another. Indeed, as I look back over all that has happened this year, there are several moments in my own journey that stand out to me, situations that have shaped my experience both of life and of faith. One in particular that I find myself reflecting on has been my ordination as an elder in the United Methodist Church. For over 13 years, I have actively discerned and worked toward living out what I believe to be God's call in my life, to serve the church in this way. I thought I knew what I was getting into when I set out on that journey all those years ago. I thought I understood what it meant to commit myself to being a true servant leader, a pastoral presence, someone who journeyed alongside and supported others in the faith. But like so many, I discovered I wasn't as prepared as I thought I was. In fact, if there's one thing I've learned from my experience, it is that there are always going to be things we do not expect. To be fair, there has been a lot of unexpected good in my journey, pleasant surprises that ultimately turned out better in the long run. I think about how positive my experience was working at camp during the summer, getting to know my fellow staff, spending time with campers, learning more about who I was and who God was calling me to be. I think about the opportunities that I've had to travel, to learn new things, and to be able to share those experiences in ways that help others grow too. I think about the friendships that I've made, the people that I've served with, and the unexpected ways that I have experienced God because of them. All of these things were things that I had not anticipated, at least not to the degree that I found them. At the same time, there were also unexpected challenges and difficulties. I didn't plan for what I would do when my grandma got sick while I was in seminary, or how I would feel when she passed away before she had the chance to see me ordained. I was not prepared for how deep or how painful all of the politicking and the power plays and the resistance to change were at all levels of the church, or how much it would impact my ministry directly. And of course, I could never have imagined having to pastor a new congregation or even simply figure out how to be the church in the midst of a global pandemic. You know, they don't exactly teach you that in seminary. It does make me wonder sometimes whether I would have made the same choice if I had known then what I do now. Would I have been as willing to answer the call if I had known how lonely and difficult it was going to be at times? Would I have even bothered to try? The metaphor of a journey is not unique to the present day. For millennia, it has been part of people's faith experience and can be found throughout our scriptures. Abraham journeyed from his homeland to the place where God told him to settle. The Hebrews journeyed out of slavery in Egypt through the wilderness to the land God had promised. The prophets went on journeys in the wilderness and in their dreams as a way of growing in their faith. And it could be said that the people journeyed both into exile and back home again afterwards. One of the more familiar biblical journeys for many of us, especially this time of year, is the journey of the Magi, which we just heard read from the Gospel of Matthew. Magi were priests of the Zoroastrian religion, well-trained in ancient science and philosophy, who lived in Persia and the surrounding regions. They studied, among other things, the heavens, with a particular emphasis on the stars, the planets, and their movements. Magi then used this knowledge to offer counsel and guidance in the royal courts of many ancient nobility. In the biblical story, a particular group of Magi discovered a new star in the sky whose appearance they had observed. Given their knowledge of the heavens, these Magi were aware that it had some significance, but not necessarily what that significance was. They set out on their journey without knowing exactly where the star would lead them or how long it would take to get to their destination. And they had no idea of the dangers or the challenges that they would face along the way. Among the greatest of these was King Herod. For both in scripture as well as in other historical accounts, Herod was known for his shrewdness, his desire to gain power for himself. He summoned the Magi and pressed them for information about the star, about its appearance and the new king that they were searching for. Then Herod gave them a mission. Go and search diligently for the child, and when you have found him, bring me word so that I may also go and pay him homage. We recognize King Herod's words as insincere and full of deceit because we know how the story ultimately plays out. We know the lengths that Herod is willing to go to protect his own power and control, up to and including slaughtering hundreds of innocent children, because we are looking back with the benefit of hindsight. But to the Magi, who were not at all familiar with Herod or with his court, it could very well have sounded like genuine concern for the newborn king. He uses all the right words and expresses, at least to them, all the right sentiments. But in the end, Herod's interests were entirely for his own power and well-being, and therein lay the danger. Like the Magi, we also encounter unexpected things in the journeys of our lives. An animal running out into the middle of the road at night, bumping into someone at the grocery store, or having to deal with a sudden family emergency are all examples of rather tangible disruptions that we sometimes experience. There are also the less tangible things, things that affect us in ways that are not always visible. Getting involved in something that we are passionate about, having to grieve a loved one who dies, or suddenly finding ourselves lost and disconnected can be just as disorienting. This past year has been a textbook example of what it's like to encounter the unexpected. Our lives were thrown into chaos when this pandemic arrived, and we suddenly had to reimagine, well, everything. Our understanding of our own history was turned upside down when we were confronted with the ways that racism, sexism, and other forms of oppression still exist in our society. Our trust in our system of government and our democratic freedoms has been shaken by the bitter rancor, disinformation, and outright disregard for the things we claim to value. Now, to be fair, there have been examples of people stepping up, reaching out, making connections, and learning new skills, not only to help themselves, but also others through these difficult times. However, there have also been many challenges. People who were suffering before have only seen their struggles magnified by this pandemic, exacerbated by conflict, and undermined by the very people charged with helping and protecting them. We have all experienced pain, frustration, loss, and grief that we did not anticipate, and we aren't really sure where to go from here. It can be tempting in situations like these to believe the voices that tell us what we want to hear. Just this past week, evangelist Sean Feucht made headlines once again for hosting large outdoor worship concert events over and against public health guidelines and restrictions. Feucht has claimed that he is fighting for religious freedom, that he is doing outreach in the name of the Lord and spreading the gospel. But everywhere that one of these events has taken place, the number of positive cases of COVID-19 has gone up significantly, often hitting those already most vulnerable. So when Feucht announced this past week that he would be holding several of these events around Los Angeles, including on Skid Row, it caused widespread alarm. Ministries and activists who were already serving the vulnerable communities in those areas spoke out. They expressed concern that the concerts would again become super spreader events, which these communities were not at all equipped to handle. It begged the question, who was this really for? When the Magi finally arrived in Bethlehem, Scripture tells us they were overwhelmed with joy. And who wouldn't be? Imagine having spent months following this mysterious sign in the heavens, not knowing where it would lead, but sensing deep down that it was important. Imagine having traveled all that way across the deserts, through various communities and foreign lands, in search of the wonder that the star must have represented. To have reached their destination in one piece, to have been that close to finding out what this was about, must have made them feel good. And yet once again, they encountered something unexpected. Instead of a palace or the home of a nobleman, the Magi found themselves outside an ordinary house, not unlike the many others that lined the streets of Bethlehem. It must have seemed strange after everything else they had been through. They had come so far in search of a glorious young ruler, the one whom the deities had blessed with the sign of a star, only to be led into the midst of the simple and the everyday of common folk. Still, the Magi remained open to the possibility that something more was at work. Indeed, they had followed the star all that way, and it had gotten them that far. What reason was there for them not to trust it? So they entered the house and saw the child with Mary, his mother. They witnessed the divine presence in the Christ child, and their lives were changed. And in response, they offered their gifts, gold, frankincense, and myrrh, and then they paid homage. The Magi's story, at least as it has been recorded in our scripture, ends with one more unexpected thing, a dream, warning them not to go back to Herod, but to instead move forward and to take a different road home. They could have easily chosen to return to Jerusalem and make their report, confident in the knowledge that they would have earned King Herod's favor, or at least managed to save themselves from his wrath. However, once again, they put their faith and trust in the alternative, did something unexpected. They remained open to the possibilities before them, and they were able to endure because of it. In fact, it was that same willingness to step out in faith and that dedication to following the signs that God had put in their midst, which allowed the church to endure all these years, even in the face of persecution, wars, famines, plagues, and disasters, the church has remained faithful to the way of discipleship and to serving one another in love. Although the how has changed, the why always remains the same. As we move into the new year, it is important for us to remember we are all on a journey, just like the Magi were. We must learn to accept that no matter how much we think we know or how well we've planned it out, there are always going to be unexpected things that we haven't accounted for. In order to find our way through, we have to stay focused and to follow the signs that God is placing all around us. We must remain open to the wonder that is the Christ child and be willing to respond accordingly when God calls. The fact that we are here today, that we exist as a congregation, is proof those who came before us committed themselves to the journey, not just for their own sake, but for the sake of those around them and those who had yet to come. They answered God's call in their lives, despite having had no way of knowing where it would lead them, and they passed that down from generation to generation. Each has had the opportunity to respond in their own way and to add another layer to the identity of Portage United Methodist Church. Now it is our turn to make our contribution and to share the responsibility. God's star still goes before us, showing us the way of love. We must choose to follow. May it be so according to God's will. Amen. All around us are signs of God's presence in our midst, calling us, inviting us to share in the work that God is doing in the world by our prayers, our presence, our gifts, our service, and our witness. Even though our building may be closed, the mission and ministry of our congregation continues, thanks to your support, financially and otherwise. There are many ways that you can give to support our congregation. You can mail your offering to the church office, or if you're in the area, you can drive by and drop it in our secure drop box outside the front door. You can call the office and we'll help you set up an electronic funds transfer that allows you to move the offering donation at a time and amount of your choosing. You can visit our website and give online using the secure donation portal there, or you can text using the information found on your screen. If you are a member of another faith community worshiping with this video, we invite you to give financially and support the ministries in your congregation so that you can help to be a part of the work that God is doing in your community. In addition to our financial gifts, God also calls us to offer up our prayers and to share together in praying not only for one another, but for all God's beloved children. Therefore, I invite you now into this moment and space as we pray together. Let us pray. Gracious and loving God, we give you thanks for this day, for the beauty of a new year filled with hope and promise, for the chance to see the dawning of a new day, and to share in beloved relationship with you and with those around us. We thank you for your Son, Jesus, who was born in Bethlehem, who was visited by wise men, and who continues to live among us, showing us what it means to love and to serve you. Because of Christ, we know that you truly understand what it means to be us, and we can trust deep down that as we lift our prayers to you, you hold them close to your own heart. God, we lift before you all those who have been able to celebrate this holy season, for celebrations of Christmas and New Year's, birthdays and anniversaries. We thank you for these lights in our midst that reflect the true light of your Christ in our lives. We thank you also for the many ways that we have to show our support and our love for one another, to reach out and connect together, even in this time of distancing, that we may truly be together in your spirit. God, we also lift before you those who are struggling, those who are hurting, who are mourning the loss of loved ones, who are feeling disconnected. God, we pray especially for the people of Nashville as they continue to pick up the pieces of the bombing that happened there on Christmas Day, and as they seek answers to the question of why such a terrible thing would happen in their midst. We pray for those in Los Angeles who are struggling with what it means to witness to your gospel, how to show love and service to one another in ways that bring life and health rather than publicity and self-interest. God, we pray for all those who have struggled this past year, especially those dealing with the effects of this pandemic, those who are suffering from the illness, those who are putting themselves at risk to provide care, to provide medical assistance, to provide essential services during these times. We pray for all those whose lives have been upended, who are frustrated with having to figure out alternative ways of doing things and dealing with changing schedules. And we pray especially for those who are feeling overwhelmed by loneliness, isolation, anxiety, and grief. We pray for the beauty of your creation and for the many ways that it is suffering because of years of neglect and abuse, pollution, and other damage that has been caused by our ignorance. We pray for those whose lives are affected by climate change and who are suffering from natural disasters. And we hold before you all those who are deeply impacted by conflicts here and around the world. We ask that in this season of Epiphany, not only would your starlight shine among us, but that you would help us to bring your peace. God, we pray for President Trump and his cabinet, for President-elect Biden and his transition team, and for all of our elected officials, wherever they may be serving, that together we might share in your vision for our world, one of your justice and your love. Holy God, help us to see the signs that you put in our lives, to follow along the journey and to go all in, so that we might end up where it is you are calling us to be and share in the glory of your most wondrous gift. We ask these things in the name of your Son, Jesus Christ, and by the power of your Holy Spirit, as we pray together the prayer Jesus taught us, saying, Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial and deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. Our closing hymn is Carol of the Epiphany. The words appear on your screen.
Streets we heard the word that seemed for
Friends, as we go from this digital space, know that we do not go alone, but with the love of God, the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, and the community of the Holy Spirit, to love and to serve God and neighbor in all that we do, now and forevermore. Go in peace. Amen.